Hello, good afternoon, good morning. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to speak here. Can you see the presentation?
Yes.
Okay, I'm Michael Küppers, the project scientist of the ESA-HERA mission. And as Christina already told us yesterday, DART and HERA are closely cooperating. The scientists working on the mission are closely cooperating, and the missions kind of work together. So that will impact next year in Dimorphos, the moon of the double asteroid Didymos. It will be accompanied by the Italian cube, the Atlicia cube, which will fly by Dimorphos a couple of minutes after the impact of that. And then 4 years later, in early 2027, the HERA spacecraft will arrive, will also bring its two CubeSats, Juventas and Milani, and will investigate the two asteroids in detail. While the change in the period of Dimorphos around Didymos will be determined by Earth-based observers practically just after the impact, that's going to happen when the Didymos is flying by Earth. The detailed investigation will then be done of the outcome of the impact will then be done a couple of years later with HERA. So the HERA mission in a nutshell, so launch will be in 2024. The cruise phase features a Mars flyby and asteroid arrival will be end of 26, early 27. Then the scheme of the asteroid encounter follows largely the strategies that was already applied for Rosetta. So there is first an early characterization phase at something like 20, 30 kilometers distance from the asteroids to measure the dynamics, the size, volume, shape, and the mass of the system. Then the two CubeSats will be released, and after that, the main spacecraft and also the CubeSats will enter the detailed characterization phase where we expect the main spacecraft to be around 10 kilometers from the asteroid, and the CubeSats will take, as their lifetime is expected to be shorter than that of HERA, will take risks earlier and will already go closer to the asteroid. Afterwards, we will try successively closer flybys that at the end will bring us to less than a kilometer, in particular to Didymon, to the small guy, in particular to really get a detailed view on the crater that was created by the DART impact. It's followed by some more technology demonstration phase, and actually the tentative end of mission is to land all the three spacecraft either on the moon or on the main body. So we have a total of 10 objectives defined that I try to summarize here in a few key points. So one key point is to be able to really measure the momentum transfer from DART to Dimorphos. We need to know the mass of Dimorphos due to the short encounter time of both DART and Lycia. This cannot be done by the mission itself. And so the accuracy will be largely increased by not having to assume the mass, but actually measuring it, which will be done by the acceleration of the spacecraft, essentially measured through radio science, through the Doppler. But we think even in this case, the most accurate measurement of the mass of the secondary is measuring the wobble of the secondary, the wobble of the primary, sorry, due to the motion of the secondary around the comb and center of mass of the two. Another main point about the mission is to understand really the impact and to investigate the interaction of the impactor with the surface of the asteroid. We have here the unique opportunity to look at the impact where we exactly know the impactor, and understanding the impact and the interaction with the body also allows us to extrapolate this impact to other asteroids of other taxonomic types, other compositions. And when the behavior models are confronted to experiments at lab scale, the most important point may not even be the numerical, the physical scale of the impact, which may not, for the dark impact, which may not be completely out of the question to reproduce on Earth. But the thing is, we are in a regime where probably both gravity and strength of the target are extremely low. And it's a unique opportunity also to have an experiment in a scale where you're in a strength regime at very low strength. This is the main point that cannot be achieved in Earth laboratories. HERA is also a technology demonstration mission. So one demonstration is automatic GNC, so essentially auto-tracking of the asteroid during the rendezvous by the spacecraft. That's probably not new for those working on Hayabusa 2 or OSIRIS-REx, but the ESA heritage on navigation around the small body is from Rosetta, which is largely 1990 technology. So in Rosetta, this was done with the ground loop. So from this point of view, this is the next step in GNC for ESA flight dynamics. The other technology demonstrations are the two CubeSats that are taken to the asteroid by HERA. Will be the first CubeSats in rendezvous around a small body. And they will have, I'll come to this only again in a minute, they have also significant scientific instruments that really provide complementary measurements to the one by HERA, including a Fabry-Perot imager and a low-frequency radar. So similar to that, HERA is not a science mission, so it's not coming from ESA Science Directorate, but it's in the Space Safety and Security Program. But nevertheless, we also expect a great science return from HERA. It's the first rendezvous mission to a binary asteroid. So we hope from the comparison of the two objects to really advance our knowledge on the formation of binary asteroids. It's also the first characterization of an asteroid that somewhere in the transition regime between strength regime and gravity regime. And together with that, it's really a unique opportunity to investigate a crater where the impact or properties are accurately known. And through one of our CubeSats, through the Juventas CubeSat, HERA will perform the first direct investigation of the internal structure of an asteroid through the monostatic radar. Expanding a little bit more on the size of Dimorphos, so this diagram of spin period versus size of asteroids essentially shows the strength regimes asteroids that rotate faster than the breakup limit would be in the gravity regime, and the size of Didymos is just in this transition regime. So we really can expect also to find new surface physics and to try to, until the first time, to see a crater that is formed in this regime. And we have seen from the sea impactor on Ryugu that we can be surprised by the impact outcome on very small bodies. This just shows that Didymos from the radar shape model that we have is expected to be a top shape, likely from your spin up the same way as Bennu and Ryugu, but now we see a top shape that it's the primary of a binary asteroid, which again thinks we will learn a lot from that about the formation and the evolution of those binary systems. This is a payload. So we have two panchromatic cameras. This is one change, relatively recent change to the mission concept. We have changed the cameras. They have no filters anymore. And otherwise, the specifications haven't changed. They are about more than five degrees field of view, and that give a resolution of 1 meter from 10 kilometers distance. To compensate for the loss of the filters, we have just recently added a spectral imager to the payload, HyperScout H. It's a slightly modified version of the HyperScout spectral imager that's currently in Earth orbit. In addition to that, we have a small LIDAR, a thermal infrared imager that's provided by JAXA. It's a further development of the imager on Hayabusa 2 in the mid-infrared with six filters, a radio science instrument, and the two CubeSats. So the Milani CubeSat features a Fabry-Pérot spectrometer working in the visible and near infrared, and a thermogravimeter essentially to measure dust fluxes of any ambient dust and possibly dust composition. And the Juventus CubeSat as a monochromatic high frequency radar, which penetration depth that depending on the material, we expect to go down to something like 20, 30 meters into the interior of the asteroids. And mostly after landing accelerometers and the gravimeter also for detailed measurement of the gravity field. That's a spacecraft design. And mostly in this view, one can see the payload accommodation on the spacecraft. So those are the two framing cameras, the thermal infrared imager and the laser, and the two CubeSats in their covers. The solar panels will be around 13 meters long, which is relatively small for an interplanetary mission. So this is the schedule. Hera just passed PDR end of last year. Is now in phase C. Everything is going to according to schedule. Some of the subsystem PDRs, notably those of the cameras, are in the next month up to April. And nominal launch date is October 2024 with an Ariane 6 rocket. And arrival at the asteroid would be 2027, and I stop here and I'm open for questions.
Thank you, Michael. Interesting. So you do have a question from Joel Marks. Will it be possible to extrapolate to some aspects of deflection by NEO, NED?
Sorry, aspects of the what?
Aspects of deflection by a NED, it says, but I don't know what
your device.
What's NED? Oh, sorry.
Nuclear explosive device. So I'll repeat the question.
I would say yes, it's an interesting question.
Okay.
I would say it's difficult because the nuclear explosion device, I mean, I guess it would be a standoff explosion. That would more push the asteroid away. I'm not sure if the impact efficiency could be directly, the momentum transfer efficiency could be directly applied to a nuclear device, but maybe others can say more about that.